Revelation 21. Oh, 22, excuse me. It says here 21. 22. Revelation chapter 22, this evening we're going to, we are finally toward, coming toward the end of Revelation. It has taken, what, 2 years?
Yeah.
But if you're going to do it right, you have to go through it slowly. So much to cover. Revelation 22 is the chapter in which is a summary of the entire book of Revelation. And it's really apparent now before, and like the great Dwight Thompson once said, he says, the time is near, we must be ready. Revelation chapter 22 talks about the last part of John's vision that he had on the Isle of Patmos. And I like what Dr. David Jeremiah said, that this was probably the best part of the Revelation, where you see actually God's blessing shown in three ways. There are three things we're going to look over this evening, and it all involves life. One is the book of life, the tree of life, and the water of life. In chapter 22, verse 1, when you look at the word life, many people don't understand what that word really means. People think life is something that you live. The word life, according to Hebrew and Greek, is a very interesting word. The best advice I was given when I was in college, when I was in school, was to actually study what the word means itself. And life is a very unique word. You can't go into the dictionary to appreciate the word life. It's not something what the word means and what it stands for. Life, according to the language itself, whether it be Hebrew or Greek, what have you, life could mean space. Life could mean time. Life can mean gift. In different languages, the word life has a different meaning. But if you look at that word life in the languages, whether it be Hebrew and Greek or Yiddish, it all points to the same thing. It points to the characteristic of life. Life is space. We do have space on this planet. There's a certain amount of space that we consume that God has given us. God has given us a certain territory in this life. Our territory is New Braunfels, Texas. Now, if God chooses to increase that which He has, then our space will grow longer. The longer you remember the Jabez prayer, please, Lord, enlarge my territory. We're talking about space. Time, that's the life that we have to live. That's the amount of time that God has given us on this earth. And I think many people take that for granted about the amount of time that we have. The amount of time that we have is purely at God's discretion. Gift is what we do with this life. Our life is a gift, but it's only a gift if we use it for God. If we use our life to help others, that's using it for God. If we use our life to bless others, we're giving it for God. If we use our life to sacrifice for others, that is a gift that comes from God. But this evening, the type of life that we're going to look at are the three things that promote, that show what life is. The first one is the book of life. And that has to do with salvation. If you are saved by the grace of God, by the blood of Jesus Christ, if you are truly born again and changed, truly born again and changed, then your name is written in the book of life. We're also going to study about the water of life. In 22, you read chapter 22, verse 1, that's the very first thing that it talks about. Is the water of life. The water of life comes to those that enhances. It increases. Then you have the other life, which is very interesting, the tree of life. The tree of life is a source of life. Now, before we get into it in a deeper way, I want you to look at chapter 22, verse 1, and we're going to start here. Here in chapter 22, verse 1, here is John saying in a narrative fashion, this is what was revealed to me. And notice in verse 1 what he says, and he showed me. I should add another life, the breath of life up there.
That's a big one. We'll add that one later. Chapter 22, verse 1 says, and he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. Now, when you read that together, when it says the throne of God and of the Lamb, you have to remember that Jesus has his own throne as well. He's the Lamb of God. He's in heaven. He is known as the Lamb of God because of the sacrifice he made for us. That's his title in heaven. To us, he is Lord and Savior and King. But in heaven, he is known as the Lamb of God. If you remember, look at verse 27 in chapter 21, which should be right above chapter 22. And there are no eyes entering anything that defileth, nor whatsoever worketh abomination and maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. That's talking about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's his book of life. Jesus knows everyone that is in the book of life. He knows every one of them intimately and in a relationship way, relationally. So when you look at the book of life, that is authored and only known by Jesus. Now, of course, God knows, but Jesus knows everyone that is in the book of life because he has had a relationship with them. If you have a family tree that goes way back generations, you may know some of your present family now, and some in maybe two or three generations back, like your grandmother, if you're blessed, your great-grandmother. But you don't know all your family tree, right? There's no way. There's no way you can know every one of your family tree. Here's the interesting thing. God knows every one of his family tree. He knows every one of them. And people, does that mean the unborn? That means the unborn as well. If those that are been aborted, which is a sin, well, I'll just say that plain as day, it is murder. I heard one preacher, and here's another thing. I don't understand how preachers become a preacher or a pastor if they have no idea what they're teaching. Does that make sense to you? Have you ever stopped to think? This gentleman said, it is not murder to have an abortion because the life in the womb is not developed. Okay, here's my question to you this evening. Can anything dead live in the human body? Is there anything dead in us right now? In the human body? Okay, what happens if your appendix dies? What do you happen if your appendix
poison.
Ruptures?
Poison.
It's poison,
it
okay?
Yeah.
It kills you. What happens if your kidney doesn't function in the body? You got to take that kidney out, right? What happens if your heart stops pumping in the body and it begins to... You got to get it out. So here's my point to you. And here is my question to this pastor. You know what? I always invite debate. Can you name anything in your body right now that is dead and decaying? Yes or no? No. There's nothing in our body that's dead and decaying. So how can you say if a doctor tells you... Here's the freaky part. This one guy said, what about cavities in your teeth? Okay. The tooth is still living, right. But it has a cavity, but it's still living.
Right.
If you don't fix that cavity, it'll get worse. Okay. Anything in the body is still living. It may be injured, it may be diseased, but it's still living. It's not dead. That's the point we're trying to make. A womb, in the child in the womb, is a living, breathing life, and it's recorded in God's book of life. If you choose to take away that child and abort it by your willful, sinful desire, that child is immediately taken to heaven. If you have a stillborn baby, if you had a child that was stillborn, purely no fault of your own, that child is in heaven. Okay? God doesn't say, oh, I didn't make it, put it in the trash can, or oh, I didn't make it to the checklist. All children, the Bible says that all souls belong to God in the book of Ezekiel.
Amen.
And that includes the unborn. So for you people out there thinking that you will never see your son or daughter that was stillborn, you will see them in heaven.
Amen.
Okay? That is part of the book of life. That is part of the book of life. That is, all souls belong to God. Now, the choice we make determines our eternity. But God doesn't make that choice for us, we do. And that's the thing about free will. Free will is a double-edged sword. A lot of people use free will as a way of getting what they want, when they want it, how they want it, but they don't understand that when they stand before the judgment seat of God, there's no defense to what they did. God says, that was your choice, and you made your bed, and you're going to lie in it, pretty much. Look what it says here in chapter 22, verse 1. The water of life, clear as crystal, it proceeds out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, on either side of the river, there was the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month. Listen to this. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations, and there shall be no more curse. But the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. This is beautiful. Look at verse 4. And they shall see his face. We will see the face of God. We will see the face of Jesus. We will see his face. We will meet God face to face. His name shall be in their foreheads. All of us were born with a name. The word name, this is very interesting.
This goes back. This is going to be awesome. You better tell your friends to watch this. This is good.
We do have a new subscriber.
Yes, we do. We're getting up to 9. Every new subscriber will get a free autographed book that's coming up by me. It says here.
But we don't know who they are.
We don't know who they are.
Yeah, that we can't see their name. And when is the book going to be published?
Very likely. Okay. Not a name. The word name, get this, means identity. Your name identifies you. Your name identifies your personality and who you are. Okay? I'll give you an example. This was from a Jewish rabbi friend of mine. Now No, he's not Orthodox. He's Messianic.
Yay.
Okay? Pita. He got after me. He says, don't call yourself Pete. Your name is Pita. He's British, by the way. Pita is very interesting. I said, sir, well, okay, what does that mean? It comes from Pedro, but don't call me Pedro. All right? I am Pita. I don't know why my parents named me Pedro. I want to change my name. I don't know why they did that. It means rock.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Okay? Here's the interesting part of it. When you look at the rock, the name Peter means this. This would explain probably my...
personality?
Personality. Chief. He's a chief.
Is it not yet?
Rock? Peter means rock. He's stout. He's stubborn and he's obstinate. Does that describe me?
Yeah.
Sure does.
Okay. It means head. He's not the tail, he's the head. And when you look at the symbol of a rock, here's the interesting part, and I have it here to prove it. Here is the symbol that it comes under. It's the cross. I have it right here. Is it a coincidence that that name has so much meaning to it? No. Who was the first disciple that was chosen?
Peter.
Jesus told him. When did Jesus say, and upon, not that he's the foundation of the church, but who did he tell that you are part of the church and being the foundation of? Peter. Who was known as the head of the disciples?
Peter.
Is that a coincidence?
No.
It means certain things. Your name means something. If you want to know what your name means, I'd suggest you go to a Christian side, and I will give you what it means. Every name, every Christian name has a meaning. Martha means servant. Mary means submissive.
I would say something, but they're women. I'm not going to get them mad. But it says here, every name has a meaning to it. If you look at verse 4, it says here, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. Now look at your notes that you have here. I want you to look at the first part of your notes. Revelation chapter 2 points, this is paradise regained. When did paradise first start? Garden of Eden, in Genesis. As I go back to Genesis, the first book of the Bible, when God created the heavens and the earth, it was perfect. And God said it was good. How do we know this? In Genesis chapter 1, verse 21, he says, and God created whales, and every living creature in the moveth, the waters that bringeth forth abundantly after their kind, every winged fowl after his kind, and God saw that it was good. He called it was very good. When he created man, he says this was also very good. He created male and female, part of the Eden covenant. This was also very good. When God created everything in 6 days, on the seventh day he rested from all the work that he had done. And God said in chapter 2, verse 3, God blessed the seventh day and he sanctified it. God blessed the seventh day for the strict purpose of having a relationship, having a talk with God. That's what the word, did you know that's what the word worship means? It means to have a just talk with God. Just to talk with him. Because in it that he rested from all the work which God created that were made. When you look at what God has done, and if you look here in the Garden of Eden, the Garden of Eden was meant to last forever. The Garden of Eden was meant to be the paradise here. What ruined it? Sin. Okay. How did that sin come about? How did it sin come about? Now I've talked to, I know this was a long time ago, but this makes perfect sense and it's biblical. The word sin comes from disobedient, not obeying, not submissive, not trusting. Lucifer was in heaven. What made Lucifer sin?
Pride.
He did not trust God. He was not submissive to God. He rebelled against God. He rebelled not only against God's authority, he rebelled God himself because he wanted to be what?
God.
Worship as God. The Garden of Eden was the devil's trophy, so to speak, because he caused it to fall by sin. It says here in chapter 2, verse 16, and the Lord commanded the man. Now here's the interesting part that people don't understand. He commanded the man, of every tree of the Garden of Eden thou mayest eat freely. But of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, thou, you shall not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest, thou shalt surely die, because of sin that was brought on by what? Disobedience. And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helpmeet for him. So out of the ground of the Lord, and out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air. But listen to this: out of Adam, he would bring forth a living creature, which became what? Eve. Here's the interesting part. The woman was never created directly from the dust of the ground. She is a byproduct, if I could use that word, of what was already created. She came from what already existed. What are we getting at, right? Here's what we're getting at. Of all the birds of the air and all the beasts of the field, they were a unique creation. Okay? God created them. And through proprietorship, which means propagation, they were given the tools in their body to exist by propagating their life. Man cannot do that. Okay? We cannot propagate life. We have the seed of it, but we're not the incubators of it. So God says there has to be an incubator to which life is promoted. And he came up with who? Woman. Woman came directly from man. She did not come from the dust of the ground. She came directly from man. In other words, she came from something that already existed. Why is that important? it's important because woman in the Bible, in the Hebrew, in the Yiddish, the word woman means what? This is going to get you.
A man or something?
Woman means of the man. Woman means of the man. Okay. Here's the importance of it. The woman is the other half. She completes the man because she completes the man when it comes to life. We're the seed of it. We're the planters, but we need a ground to plant the seed. Okay? That's where the woman comes in. You're the incubators of life. You promote life. You preserve life. The woman has the three P's. You ready for this? This is awesome. I hope you brought that down. That's a test for you right there.
Can we get a coupon?
Oh, I gotta get more coupons.
We need to go buy them.
Yeah, I'm free.
Woman, you have three P's. You preserve life. You don't take life, you preserve it. You promote life. In other words, you do everything in your power to make sure that life lives. Amen?
Yeah.
Then, you're supposed to protect that life. That's why abortion is a sin. You're to preserve it. You're to promote it. And by all means, you're supposed to protect life. That is why it is very important in the eyes of God that when he created woman, it says here, God caused Adam to fall into a deep sleep in verse 21 in chapter 2. Adam, you're going to sleep for a long time. But I'm going to take one of your ribs and I want to make something that will actually help you. Yes, she helped. That was a good one. That deserves a double coupon from Mr. Ed. It says here.
What did he say?
No, I'm not going to say it. We'll say it in a minute. He helped them, all right. Helped them sin. It says here in verse 20. It says here in chapter, verse 22.
Yeah.
The Lord God, taken from man, he made a woman and brought her unto the man. And the Adam said, this is now bones of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and should be called woman because she was taken out of man. Okay. Here's the part that we need to focus on as far as this is concerned. The Bible says that because woman was created as the other part of life, she's half of the life of the other man. Man is the seed, the woman is the ground. She is the incubator. She promotes, preserves, and protects that life in her womb. The womb is sacred in the eyes of God. Amen? The womb is sacred and should not be tampered with or have nothing to do with in any way. Okay? In other words, and here's the thing about this at the time with Adam and Eve, and this is very important. There was only one man that was supposed to be in the territory of the woman. Who was that? Adam. Okay? God created her especially for him. They coexisted, they propagated, they had a family. This is very important in today's society because God makes certain people for certain people. God makes certain people for certain people. You can't fit a square peg in a round hole. It doesn't work. God makes certain people for certain people. Abraham had a wife for a certain wife. David had Bathsheba. Amen. Mary had Joseph. Matchmaker was who? God. You cannot go against God's will and way. And for you gay people out there, it's not Adam and Steve, it's Adam and Eve. Okay, it doesn't work. I don't care if your church teaches that gay is acceptable. When it's acceptable with God, then it's acceptable with us, right? When God says that homosexuality is not a sin, then we will accept it. And a lot of people say, well, leave them alone. Let them live their life. You know what happens when you leave them alone and let them live their life? They go to hell.
Does God love them, just not the sin?
If they stay in their sin, they become the objects of hatred. And I can show you in the Psalms where it says that. Like Pharaoh. Did God hate Pharaoh?
No. Hardened his heart.
He hardened his heart. When Pharaoh rejected God, what did Jesus say for those? Either you for me or what? You're against me. If Pharaoh was against the Lord, what does that make Pharaoh? An enemy. Okay? He's an enemy. When he says, Jacob have I loved and Esau have I hated, what did that make Esau? An enemy. We have enemies. Yeah, we have. God has a lot of enemies. God has enemies on the scene. There are people, the Islamic religion like ISIS, they hate God. They hate the Bible. They hate Christians. They're killing Christians in the Middle East because they stand for the true God. And they hate Christians. Okay? God hates as well. God hates sin. God hates the devil. When we hate something, we want nothing to do with it. Right? Brussels sprouts. Lima beans. Let's see if anyone takes a bit of that, right?
I like them.
Okay, there's some that don't. Spinach. But the point I'm trying to make is that if you don't like something, if you hate something, you're going to stay away from it.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you think the devil will ever be entered into heaven again? Do you think the devil will ever be welcome again? No, he's done. He is gone. He's finished. Death warrant has been signed. It's just time to fulfill it. But when you look at life the way that God intended it to be, and you look at it now that the way it is, we messed it up. Now look at chapter 3. This is relative to the Garden of Eden. The serpent was there. He was more subtle, more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. He said unto the woman, had God said, again, with doubt, you should eat of every tree of the garden. Now remember, God commanded the man in verse 16 in chapter 2 not to eat of it. He didn't say anything about the woman. Why? Man is in charge. He was the foundation. The woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, in the middle of it, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither you shall touch it. Don't even touch it, or you will die. The woman said, the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. In other words, he called God a liar.
A liar, right.
God does not know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. God doesn't want you to have that power, so that's why he told you to stay away from it. See, God wants you to live a life that's boring. God wants you to live a life that's not exciting. God doesn't want you to have fun. What do we consider fun? We had fun Friday night at a Christian concert. Nobody was smoking pot. Nobody was flashing the devil signs. Are you getting it? Nobody was cussing. Nobody was fussing. There was nothing ugly about it, but we had fun. People need to have beer to have fun. People need to have drugs to have fun. People need to make sex jokes to have fun. People need to do derogatory things to have fun. What is it does it take to have fun? The devil tells young people today, you are going to lead a boring life. He wants you to live like Mother Teresa. He wants you to live like Friar Tuck. No fun. You're going to have a boring life. Everything. That's what the devil did with Eve, saying, Eve, you can eat of this fruit, nothing's going to happen to you. What's God going to do? Going to kill you? And the woman saw the tree was good for food in verse 6, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise. She looked at it. She rationalized how good it would taste. She took of it and ate it, and gave it to her husband, and he did eat it as well. Verse 8, they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam said to his wife, Adam and his wife, who married them? God did. Here's another point that I always tell couples I'm going to marry. God should have brought you two together, and God is the one that's going to marry you. Okay? If God had a choice of women or men in your life, would this be the choice? I don't know. It's not an answer. God specifically made Eve for Adam. That's why it says in verse 8, Adam and his wife. God brought them together and God married them. That's a sacred marriage. Okay? Did you know that in heaven, a part of the book of life is of marriage and of life, who you're with? Not everything, not every one of those is going to be sanctified. Not all of those are going to be honored by God. If God didn't have a say in it, if God didn't put it together, God says, that's an X. Okay. I got X too. I'm sure I will by my name. And God is going to get after me. And he says, son, I said, I understand. Go ahead and hammer it. I mean, he does it in love. He says, I love you, but I love you. You're my servant. But again, you are the rock. You were stubborn and obstinate. It cost you. It did. It says here in verse 8, in the cool of the day, Adam and his wife hid themselves in the presence of the Lord God among the tree of the garden. And the Lord God said unto Adam and said, where are you? Why are you hiding from me? Can you imagine hiding from God? What an awesome thing to hide from God. Not want to be with God. Not want to communicate with God. People that are sick should run to God. People that are depressed should run to God. In any situation in life, you should want to run to God. You should never want to ever stay away from God. Especially if you have sinned, you should want to run to Jesus and repent of your sin. Verse 13, the Lord God said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? What is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. It's pretty hard to lie to God, isn't it? He already knows. Why do that? When you look at what has happened here, because of sin that entered in, we go to chapter 4. Adam and Eve had Cain and Abel. Cain and Abel. Abel was beloved and Cain was not. The first murder took place, and ironically, it was in a family way. When Cain killed Abel in cold blood. Was that a curse on the family?
Yes,
it was. Because they disobeyed God.
It started all this.
And it started and it has gone on from ever since. Why are we going back to Genesis? Because in the book of Revelation, perfection is the order of the day. There will be no sin. There will be no murder. There will be, you remember what the verse is? There shall be what? No more curse. If you disobey God, you have just guaranteed yourself a curse. Because God is not going to bless anything that's not within his will, that's not part of his way, and that is not according to him. God won't bless it. You can ask all you want, it's not going to be blessed. Adam and Eve, she conceived and she bore Cain in pain. Childbirth is one. If you ask a lady, it is probably the most painful stage of life that you could go through, is a childbirth. The closest that we as men has come to that I found out was kidney stones. I've had kidney stones. Do not get kidney stones. Okay, pray to God that God will spare you a kidney stone. It feels like half the body where the kidney is, it goes numb and there's pain. You can't sit down, you can't stand up, you can't do anything. You're in pain until that little bitty stone passes through you. A little bitty thing can cause that much pain. Have you ever seen a stone? I've seen my stones. They're little bitty. But they cause the greatest pain in your body. Okay? That pain does not compare to childbirth. So when you look at that, and now where do you think that pain came from? Why was there pain in childbirth? Eve. Because Eve sinned. Think about this, ladies. Think about it. I want you to think about this. When you have your children, there'll be no pain. Like the Duggar family, they could have had 19 kids and she would have felt no pain. No Novocaine, nothing. Just no pain.
Kidney stone, you'd be all right.
No pain in childbirth. The point I'm trying to make is that because of the curse, men have to work. You know, if Adam did not sin, we wouldn't have to work. There would be no childbirth and pain for Eve. She didn't have to redecorate the Garden of Eden. It was already perfect. Everything was